of Jesus, to you all, and especially to our visitors this morning, Jack and Lynn, good to see you with us. Lovely to see Fiona and David as well. Before we begin our worship of God, I'll ask Ian, the Reverend Ian Beaton, to come and give us the notices for the coming week. So thank you, Ian.
Both services today will be taken by the Reverend Alex Stewart at the evening service at his usual time of 6:30 p.m. Monday, the New Zealand Stretch, 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. and we are going to recovery as Alec has shifted
to Monday
to Monday evening as well. So that's the road to recovery at 7:30. And that was originally on Tuesday. So Tuesday's now a vacant day.
Shifted my date to preparation.
So Wednesday with the prayer meeting at 7:30. Thursday is also a night day. Friday we have the drop-in cafe plus Eastern Bantra food bank at the end to 1 p.m. Then there will be a lunch, and that's followed by Christianity at school the first day. After we know that. So next Lord's Day, the services are at the usual times of 11 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. Preacher would be the Lord willing, the Reverend Alex Stewart. I think that's
it. Thank you, yes, and thank you for giving a heads up. It's worth mentioning again, after the drop-in, we're beginning our first series of Christianity Explored, which will involve lively soup and sandwiches and fellowship and fun and questions. Don't know a good answer, but we're going to have a lot of fun talking. We're going to sing from the Word of God in Psalm 110 from Scottish Psalter, the Scottish metrical version of the Word of God. Psalm 110. We'll sing the whole psalm. The Lord, that's on page 390. The Lord did say unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thy foes a stool whereon thy feet may stand. We'll sing this whole psalm to the praise of the Lord, and we'll stand to sing if you are able.
Oh,
gracious God and our loving Heavenly Father, we look to you this morning to bless us. We pray, Lord, that you would come and help us as we pray, as we worship you, Lord, that we would do so in spirit and in truth. We pray for your blessed Holy Spirit to lead us in the way we should go. We do praise you this morning, Lord, that you are a God of grace and mercy, and that your mercy is new every morning. Your mercies are new every morning. Lord, your benefits, your gracious benefits, are past numbering. We thank you this morning that you are the sovereign God. You are in control, not just of the universe in its entirety, but our lives and our situations and every single thing. We thank you for that, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that we can find peace in that today, knowing that you are a good God and that you, Lord, reign. We thank you, Lord, for the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, whom to know is life eternal. We thank you for that beautiful gospel, that beautiful Saviour this morning, Lord, your own beloved Son. We thank you for the wonderful word of grace that comes to us. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Lord, that's a glorious message this morning. It's a glorious message every morning. It's a wonderful truth that you in love and grace have sent your Son to us. Lord, you came to be with us, to dwell with us, God with us. We pray that we could truly take these truths to our hearts, to ourselves this morning, as we reflect, Lord, upon who you are and upon who we are. We recognize, Lord, that of ourselves we are sinful and we go our own way. We're like sheep going astray. But we thank you, Lord, that you are the one who has come to seek and to save that which was lost. You, O Lord, did not leave us to ourselves. And this morning, Lord, we come to you and we acknowledge and bless you for your goodness and grace, and we confess our sin, Lord. We confess, Lord, that we've wronged you. We confess our wandering hearts. We confess, Lord, that we are more interested in ourselves often than we are in you. O Lord, our God, we ask today for your mercy and forgiveness, and that this day, Lord, you would fill us with your Spirit and your word, Lord, that our hearts would be revived, and that you would take from us for this short while, Lord, anything that would distract us from the worship of God, and help us, Lord, to be attentive to your voice this day, Lord, and to listen to you, Lord, and to embrace your truths, to embrace you, Lord, and to lift up your name in this service and in our lives, in our work and witness, our walk and worship, that you would be the center. We bless you and thank you, Lord, for all that you have given us this day. And we thank you for the hope that is laid up for us in heaven and in the new creation of heaven and earth with our Lord and Savior, where God himself will dwell with us and where God himself will wipe away every tear from every eye, and where there will be no more sickness, death sought over him. We thank you for that, Lord, because now we are all too conscious that we live in a world of sickness, sorrow, death, and pain. And we are conscious, Lord, of suffering all around us. We're conscious, Lord, of suffering in every home. And there is not a family or home that is not touched by something, Lord. And Lord, we pray that today every family and every home would find their hope, their comfort, their solace in the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who is the consolation of Israel, the one who is the consolation of his people, the one who is the consolation of the world. May we know today, Lord, the deep consolation of the gospel. As we think, Lord, of those who are sick and suffering, we remember Katrina, we remember Beth, Lord. We remember Nora, Lord. And our Father in heaven, we do pray that you would raise them up, that you would give them strength for the day, and that the joy of the Lord would be their strength. We remember, Lord, Tracy and Sheila. Oh, Father, we pray that you would go very close to them today and that you would help Tracy in hospital. Strengthen her, strengthen Sheila, Lord, and may they know your presence and your peace and your power, Lord, in their own situation, in their lives today. And we do remember Deidre and Alan and all their children, Lord. Father God, have mercy. And Lord, we thank you this day that as we look to the beginning of a new chapter in the history of our nation, Lord, as we again, Lord, seek to find our own way in the world out of the European block, that it would be a time of blessing, a time of consolidating friendships and consolidating the union, consolidating everything that is of importance and of value and of worth. And we pray most of all, Lord, that it would be a time, Lord, of seeking God. We do thank you, Father, that our Prime Minister has ventured to defend Christians and to really seek the protection of Christians, not only in the UK, but worldwide. And we thank you for that, Lord. And despite our ideas of politics, we recognize this, that there is no authority except from God. And we thank you, Lord, that you are raising up a voice for your people. And we do thank you for this in the United States, Lord. Whether we agree with economic policy, foreign policy, we do agree on this, on the human rights, Lord, and of the freedom of religion. Father God, we thank you for that. And we pray, Lord, for the persecuted minorities in our country and throughout the world, Lord. We pray, Father, that you would give peace and strength, stability, Lord, and security to them. We especially think of places where Christians are persecuted and bowed down and afflicted. We pray, Lord, that you would sweep through these countries, Lord, in mighty power, Lord, showing the greatness of your name, showing the greatness of your power, Lord, and showing the greatness of your grace and love, Lord, to turn evil people from their evil, Lord, and to yourself. So restrain evil, we pray this morning, Lord. And we pray as your word goes out, Lord, this morning in Lennoxtown and in the UK, Scotland, we think specifically of our friends at the Free Church. We pray for every pulpit to have that wonderful anointing and that all your people, Lord, everywhere would receive the word of God and rejoice in you, Lord. And Lord, that they could know that despite the sufferings of this world, that they are not worthy to be compared to the glory that will be revealed in them. And our gracious God, we do remember the work of the gospel here in Lennoxtown, Lord. We thank you for all the things, Lord, that are going on in the name of Jesus, and all that you have orchestrated, all that you have brought about, and in your sovereign grace, all whom you are reaching out to, and all whom you are bringing into a relationship with yourself. We do remember those who are struggling, Lord, with the depression, those who are struggling, Lord, with the circumstances that are just so overwhelming that they just don't know what to do. Lord, I pray, we pray, that you would reveal yourself as you did to the three in the furnace. That, Lord, it is so often in the furnace of affliction and suffering that you reveal yourself in ways that cannot be put into words. So we thank you for that, Lord. And we pray for your suffering people today, Lord, that there would be a blessing for them wherever they are. And Lord, we pray today that those struggling with addictions, struggling with various issues that come from addictions, Lord, that you would be merciful, Lord, to strengthen them, to help them, and to grant them a willing spirit to sustain them, Lord. And we remember Eric and Diane, Lord, this morning in Buckinghamshire. We pray that they would be rested, Lord, as they prepare to come back up north, and that you would take them safely home, Lord. And that they would return, Lord, in spite of the journey, refreshed and in the power of the Spirit. We do pray then for these things, Father. In the precious name of Jesus, we do pray that you would take control of every aspect of this service, Lord. That's what's not of you would fall to the ground. And Lord, when all is said and done, that you would have all the praise, the honor and glory, and when we go from here, Lord, that we could truly acknowledge that it was good for us to have been here together. And we pray, Lord, in the precious name of Jesus and for his sake, Lord. Amen. Mm-hmm. We'll sing our first hymn, which is beautiful hymn. To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go. It's often forgotten that it was the love of God the Father, the love of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that underpins the atonement. And here especially the love of God the Father.
To God be glory, great things he has done, so loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life an atonement for sin. Oh, heaven's redemption.
to Hebrews, and we're going to read from verse 16 in chapter 3. We're going to read through verse chapter 4. That's on page 1277. For who were those who heard and yet rebelled? Was it not all those who left Egypt led by Moses? And with whom was he provoked for 30 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose bodies fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who were disobedient? So we see that they were unable to enter because of unbelief. Therefore, while the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have failed to reach it. For good news came to us just as to them, but the message they heard did not benefit them because they were not united by faith with those who listened. For we who have believed enter that rest, as he has said, as I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Although his works were finished from the foundation of the world, for he has somewhere spoken of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And again, in this passage, he said, they shall not enter my rest. Since, therefore, it remains for some to enter, and those who formerly received the good news failed to enter because of disobedience, again, he appoints a certain day, today, same through David so long afterward, in the words already quoted, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken of another day later on. So then there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works, as God did from his. Let us therefore strive to enter that rest, so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart, and no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. So then we have a great, a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Amen. And we thank God for that reading of his precious holy word. And we pray he would bless it to us, and to his own name be honor, praise, and glory. Once again, we'll sing in the Scottish metrical psalms from Psalm 139, and that is on page 432. And we'll sing from verse 7. And we'll sing to the end of verse 14. From thy spirit, whither shall I go? or from thy presence fly. I send to heaven, lo, thou art there, there if in hell I lie. To the end of verse 14, thee will I praise, for fearfully and strangely made I am. Thy works are marvelous, and right well my soul doth know the same. From verse 7, from thy spirit, to the trial of love. Share our faith openly. We bless you for these things, Lord. And this morning, Lord, we remember our friends who are not able to do that. So be with them where they are, Lord. We thank you for taking Amy safely home, Lord, and her friends. We pray for Amy and her studies that you would look after her, Lord. Bless her and help her to resume her studies, Lord, in a way that would be a blessing to her and that she would make significant progress. And we pray this for our friends as well, Lord. We look to you, Father, then, to open our minds up to receive the things of God in Christ. We pray you would teach us, Lord, that your Spirit would lead us into your truth and that we could truly acknowledge, Lord, your goodness and grace to us here this morning. And as always, Lord, we pray that you would have all the praise, honour and glory. And we pray as we go from here that we could say, thank you, Lord. It was good for us to have been here. In Jesus' name we ask it, Lord, and for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
A Roman philosopher called Seneca, you may have heard of him. Certainly not everybody's heard of him, but you do get these names coming up now and again. And he was Seneca the Younger, but he once said, the greatest man is he who chooses the right with the most invincible resolution, who resists the soul's temptation from within and without, and who bears the heaviest burdens cheerfully, who is the calmest in storms and the most fearless under menaces and frowns, whose reliance on truth and virtue and on God is most unfaltering. And that was from a Roman philosopher. And what a wonderful picture from a Roman philosopher, really, of our Lord Jesus Christ. And then we have a Greek philosopher, Plato, and he says, to test whether a just or righteous man is truly just and righteous, everything of value in his life will be stripped from him. Ultimately, his life will be taken from him in the cruelest of manners to see if he can remain righteous until the end. After all, he had good things in his life. Perhaps he was righteous in order to do good things in his life. The only way to test righteousness is to give this man every injustice the world can inflict. Plato writes that in his Republic, in his writings. And then he says, we can be sure in that case whether he is just, that is righteous, for righteousness' sake, or for the gifts and the honors. So we must strip him bare of anything but righteousness. And then he says, incredibly, the stripping bare of the man culminates in his death by crucifixion. This was so long before the birth, the death, and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We read in Hebrews about the greatness of Christ in his being greater than the angels, greater than Moses, greater than Joshua, greater than the temple. He is the temple. And now we read about him in his greatness as high priest. We have the greatness of Jesus. And the writer to the Hebrews, who is anonymous, we don't know who it was. Some think it was Paul, but inward evidence would suggest it wasn't. The writer says, since then we have a great high priest. He is talking to the believers. And he is pointing out that it is to us, the believers, who have this great high priest. He is our high priest. And the high priest is one who is mediator between God and man. He is the one who makes intercession. Everything about Jesus is given down. And in the first two sections of the book, like we said, superior to the angels, superior to Moses, superior to Joshua, and now his priesthood is superior to the Levitical Aaronic priesthood. Jesus is the great high priest. He's not simply a high priest, he's the great high priest. So that's what I want to look at, three things. Jesus is the great high priest who is supreme. Jesus is the great high priest who is sympathetic. And Jesus is the great high priest who is sustaining. Now, it's a fact that no one in Israel could be both king and priest at the same time. Now, we see in our systems of government, in the House of Commons and the House of Lords, they're sort of like checks and balances, aren't they? You know, they try to ensure that we don't get anything that's forced upon us. Now, perhaps some people would have something to say about that. And the House of Lords are an elected, but they serve a function to help the nation to offset the abuse of power. And that's what we want to avoid at all costs, the abuse of power. We see the same thing in the US system of government with the two houses of the Senate and the Congress. Checks and balances. The whole thing is that as a republic, to preserve America as a republic, Britain is a democracy, and we know that's not perfect. Even the king in Israel was to guard the purity of Israel's worship. But sadly, as in our day, the kings and the priests were abject failures. Now, we may think our politicians are abject failures, but, you know, hey, I failed in a few things myself, you know. When the kings and the priests would fail abjectly, the Lord would send them prophets to call the nation back to the true worship of God in faith and repentance. A prophet of God could be a king. David, he was a king and a prophet, but he couldn't be a king and a priest, a king and a prophet and a priest. A prophet could be a priest. Priests were prophet. The priests couldn't be prophets and kings. And no, a prophet could be an ordinary person like Amos. He was called to prophesy to the northern kingdom. The prophet was to speak with the authority of God, regardless of opposition from ungodly kings and priests. And there was plenty of it from ungodly kings and priests. And we have ungodly kings. We have ungodly rulers. We have ungodly people in church leadership. And we have to speak the word of God to them. And we have to pray for them that we might live a peaceable life. That's what the Bible says. We are to pray for these people. We are to intercede for them, not just in church. We are to intercede for them in our quiet times, in our corporate prayers, in our meetings together, and what God's in our secret places, because what God sees in secret, he will reward openly. What we do, let's do it unto the Lord and not unto man. And today, the prophetic voice of the church must speak the word of God. No matter what the opposition from the kings, the state, or the priests, the church, because there's opposition from both, we know that Jesus is our high priest, and he holds the office of king and of prophet and of priest. He is the only one that holds three offices. And a prophet of God, like we say, is someone who reveals God, speaks for God, and communicates to people the truth that God wants them to know. Jesus did all this. because he said he came to do the will of the Father. He came not only to do the will of the Father, he came to reveal the Father. And that's in Matthew 11:27, Luke 22:42, and he came to speak the things of the Father. John 8:28 and 12:49. Jesus is the prophet just like Moses. Jesus is a mediator just like Moses, but greater than Moses. Greater as a mediator, greater as a prophet, and he's a king like David, but greater. He's the greater son of David. God told Moses that the priesthood would belong to Aaron and his descendants by a lasting ordinance. Aaron was made high priest, and it continued in the family line. And the line of Aaron served as priests and high priests until the destruction of the temple in 70 AD. And Caiaphas was the high priest in the day of Jesus. And he was a Sadducee. And that means he was from the sort of ruling upper class dynasty of Israel, and they didn't believe in the resurrection. The Pharisees were the laymen, they were the religious guys, they believed in the grace of God, they believed in the resurrection. Sadly, they didn't believe in Jesus. Well, some of them did. Caiaphas was the high priest. He didn't believe in the resurrection at the end of the age. And when Lazarus was raised from the dead, I don't believe in the resurrections, I don't believe in these things at all. And here we have Lazarus raised from the dead, which was not strictly speaking a resurrection, but rather a revivification, because when the resurrection comes, we will all have new glorified bodies. But Lazarus was raised from the dead, and instead of giving glory to God, that God had sent his son, Caiaphas said, how are we going to kill him? We need to kill him. Because what's going to happen is, we're going to lose our place and our power. We can't have that. Religion must triumph. Never mind grace. The Son of God has no place in religion. Judaism, for many of the religious people, have become a status symbol, a position of power, to retain power, and it was a place where they could have power to kill Jesus. They had a form of godliness, but no power. Their power was carnal. And there is a carnal power. And we must remember that the civil magistrate is also the servant of God. And he works God's will. But of course, often the civil magistrate rebels against God. And that is where the voice of the church, the prophetic voice of the church, has to speak out. And we need to keep speaking the word of God. Not shaking our fist, speaking the word of God into every situation. But you see, Jesus, we're told, we do not, so then we have a great high priest. He's a great one because he passed through. He's great because he's God. He's great because he's the prophet, priest, and king. He's great because he's the one who passed through the heavens. Our great high priest is greater than Aaron. He passed through the heavens. What does it mean? Well, in Hebrews 1, verse 3, we read, but after Jesus, after having made purification of the cleansing for sins, he sat down at God's right hand. He sat down because he had finished the work of redemption. But here, his work of intercession was continuing. The same thought is here as well as in 1:3. Jesus passed through the heavens. Here we are shown that in order to deal with God, we have to pass through the heavens, and we can't do that because our sins are keeping us down, our sins are blocking us. God is transcendent, and God is separate from human beings. Yet, God is with us in Jesus, and Jesus is the one who has passed through the heavens. Jesus, as the supreme and great high priest, has gone through the heavens. In the Old Testament, like we said, the high priest was mediator between God and the Israelites. Once a year, on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, he entered the Holy of Holies and he sprinkled blood on the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant as a sacrifice for the sins of the people. And he performed this year after year after year after year, because one animal sacrifice was never enough. And we're told that all of them were never enough, because the blood of bulls and goats cannot take away sin. They can only make a person outwardly clean, ritually clean. What truly cleansed the Israelites was that they looked forward to the Word of God and the one great sacrifice, the promises of God. They trusted God and believed there was one to come who could save them, who could deliver them. And Jesus has passed through the heavens, entered the presence of God by virtue of his sacrifice. It's saying the same thing as Hebrews 1:3, although the language is different. Jesus has entered the sanctuary or presence of God as the Son of God, who is superior to angels, superior to Moses, and superior to the Levitical priesthood and Aaron's high priest. He is our great high priest, and he is supreme, and he has brought believers near to God, so we can enjoy fellowship with him. He's supreme because his person is supreme. He is the Son of God from eternity, who became flesh. He's supreme because his sacrifice is supreme. He, as a priest would offer sacrifices, Jesus offered himself. He is the high priest, and he is the sacrifice. He laid himself on the altar. His sacrifice is supreme, and his name is supreme, Lord. That was the name above all names. And because he is the great high priest, because he is supreme, we're told to hold fast. Jesus is the Son of God. He's our great high priest. He's passed through the heavens. Christians should hold on to their confession. They should not ever turn away from their confession of faith. Hold fast to your confession. You need to do it. I need to do it. We need to hold fast to our faith. And the Christian life is often very difficult because we're sinful, and the world around us is sinful, and the world around us has different values and morals to the Word of God and to what Christians have. And even our civilized Western culture is becoming more and more hostile towards Christians and toward the Christian faith. The evil of man and Satan is making insidious inroads and attacks, and often poor Christians can get downhearted, discouraged. They see their own sin, they see the oppression of the evil one and man, and they're praying long about a situation and it's not seeming to change, and they get discouraged. And that's a weapon that the devil uses against Christians. Discouragement, disappointment, disillusionment. But Christ today wants us to know that he is our great high priest who has passed through the heavens, and he's the one interceding for us. Now, one of the great scriptures is when Jesus told Peter that Satan had desired to sift him as wheat. Simon, Simon, Satan has desired to sift you as wheat, as wheat. Now, Satan had wanted this. This was a test for Peter. Satan has desired it And then Jesus said, but I prayed for you. Look who prayed for him. Maybe Satan's attacking you, but look who is praying for us and interceding for us. Christ is praying for us. I can't remember, was it Luther or Spurgeon that said, if I could see Jesus praying in the next room, he said, I wouldn't fear any devil in hell, he said. And that's the thing. Christ intercedes for his own. So sometimes Christians can get discouraged and think about packing it and giving up. However, we don't, because we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens, and he's gone before us. Jesus is our great high priest because he's not just a man like Aaron or his descendants. He is the Son of God, the perfect righteous man. Now, the word confession in the original language means the faith the readers have taken hold of. And it's the faith they've received, and it's that whole body of faith. And they should hold fast to it and not let slip away that whole body of teaching. But holding fast to our confession is not simply giving a wee nod to the doctrine, to the Westminster Confession of Faith, or taking all the boxes. No. It's holding fast, believing it, and walking in it. And as we do, Christ will work in us, and Christ will be formed in us. Have you slipped up and made a mess of things? Well, I don't think the Lord was surprised. Every one of us at times slip up and make a mess of things. And the very thing we thought we would never do is the thing that sometimes we do. Moses was the meekest man on earth, and he got angry. The meekest man on earth got angry. Because, of course, the real meekest man on earth is the Lord Jesus Christ. And as we allow Christ to form in us, we will see the fruit of God in our lives. But in order to do that, we need to hold fast to the Word of God. And we need to allow God to work in us by His Spirit. Jesus has, by His person and work, secured forever for us the access to the presence of God. No one can come to the Father except through Jesus. There is no other Savior. Don't ever get this mistaken. There is only one high priest. There's no other priest that can intercede for us before the throne like Jesus. Yes, every Christian is a priest themselves in their own right, and we are a kingdom of priests, but there's only one high priest. There's only one high priest we can come to cleanse us from sin. There's no other Savior, there's no other sacrifice, there's no other high priest. And the Hebrews are warned, hold fast. And that same warning and exhortation is for us. They must not turn from Jesus or his priestly sacrifice. We must not do that. There's forgiveness in no other. There's no forgiveness. After looking to Jesus, there's no forgiveness in turning to the Levitical sacrifices or to the Levitical priesthood. There's only one priest that we can have intercession through. There is forgiveness in no other. And of course, if they turn back to the Levitical priesthood, they are rejecting Jesus, and they are cut off from God. And that's the seriousness of it. Once you come to Jesus, it's only Jesus. There's no other way. And even before you come to Jesus, he's the only way. The Bible is plain as to the identity of the high priest. It's Jesus. It's not Mary, not some other saint who passed away. It's not one of the church fathers or ancient patriarchs. It's Jesus Christ. There is one God and one mediator between God and the man, Christ Jesus. The Aaronic priesthood is past. It has been superseded. It has been replaced by Jesus Christ. And Jesus, the high priest, is supremely, the high priest who's sympathetic, where one who feels with us. He is able to sympathize with our every temptation, hurt, and weakness. Jesus truly understands us. He understands what it's like to be deserted. All his friends even left him. He understands what it's like to be lonely. He understands what it's like to be betrayed, hurt, rejected, abused. His family, even his family turned. And he also knows what it's like to die. He was even killed. He suffered death, experienced it all, yet without sin. He is not only able to sympathize with us, he is able to help us, because he is the way to victory over every temptation, disappointment, discouragement, or hurt. And Jesus reminds us of this. John 16:33. I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart. I have overcome the world. You see, in the world there is tribulation. That's a fact. Christians undergo tribulation. Where do we go for our peace? It's in Christ, because he has overcome the world. We have the one who was tempted at every point as we were, and he didn't sin. He has overcome without sin. And that's the way we overcome, by trusting in Christ. We are assured by Jesus we will have tribulation, but our victory is in Jesus. He's experienced what we have. He qualifies to be the great high priest because he was incarnated in our likeness. He experienced our humanity without sin, and he can truly understand it. There was a Presbyterian minister in the US in the 40s, his name was Dr. Stuart Nye Hutchison, and he told the story about a boy who had lost his right hand. And he felt so badly about it that he didn't want to see anyone. His father said, I'm going to bring the minister to see you. The boy said, I don't want to see him. But the father brought the minister anyway. And when he looked, the boy saw the minister had no right arm. There was an empty sleeve. And he came over to the boy and says, I haven't any hand either. I lost mine when I was a boy, and I know how it feels. And the thing is, whatever we're going through, nobody else could understand the word. That minister could understand it, because he had gone through the same thing. Well, Jesus knows he suffered everything that we suffer, yet without sin, in some form or another. Jesus has suffered every kind of thing that we suffer, yet without sin. That's a great mystery, but it's true. Christ has walked in our shoes, but without sin. He truly understands us. He's our sympathetic high priest. You know, just yesterday, I used to have real painful feet when I had a bad thing of diabetic neuropathy a few years ago, which was thankfully got better. And Donava came in, and Donava was always in pain every day. But she came in, she had taken Jock out. But she came in and she was crying with the pain of her feet. And at that second, I understood more about the novice pain than I had in a long time. Because I knew how bad that was. So I was able to go and take hold of her feet and pray with her, that God would bring relief for her. And it was a prayer of compassion, but it was a prayer of empathy and sympathy, because yes, I know what it's like to absorb things like that. And I was preparing this sermon, and I thought, wow, you know, that's really astonishing that God would show me something like that. He's our great sympathetic high priest. We have a sympathetic high priest, and we have a high priest who sustains us. We can call upon God boldly. We can come boldly to the throne of grace. We don't need to come hiding ourselves, you know. The throne of grace refers to the throne which grace flows from. And it's really talking about the power and the majesty of God himself in his person. And the word translated boldly means free and open speech. So we can talk to God like we talk to each other. But obviously, we need to be especially careful to be reverent and humble before God. And it speaks of an attitude that's free from fear and plainness, outspokenness even. We can be outspoken to God, but not irreverent. That doesn't mean outspoken, doesn't mean irreverent. Now, I know many people who are outspoken and, you know, what they've said makes sense. And they've not insulted anyone. They've spoken the truth. It also is in terms of somebody who's high ranking, having courage to come to that person with confidence, knowing that we will be heard. And friends, I want to encourage you today that Jesus will hear you. And you can be confident in coming to him and speaking to him, telling him what you're going through. That we have a high priest to whom we can come boldly. We can confidently pour our hearts out before this sympathetic, understanding Jesus. And you know what? When we do that, we're told we will obtain mercy and find grace. This is the most encouraging. Mercy and grace are not based on our prayers. You know, it's not the power of my prayer or your prayer. Mercy and grace are not based in our prayer. Mercy and grace are rooted in God, in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not our prayers that even saves us. It's God in Christ alone. And yet he is pleased to lead us to his throne in prayer. So we ought to humbly and reverently and yet boldly expect grace and mercy. We should expect an answer because of who Jesus is and what he has done for us. He's unsurpassingly great. And we can truly believe that he hears us. Mercy is not getting what we deserve, because as sinners we deserve God's judgment. Perhaps you felt you deserved nothing but the worst from God. But the thing is, in Jesus Christ, God does not treat you or me for sins deserved. Isn't that wonderful? As a father has compassion on his children, that is the way God treats us. Just finally, J. Campbell Morgan, who was a wonderful preacher in London, Westminster Chapel, he said, "I'm never tired," he said, "of pointing out that the Greek phrase translated in the time of need is a colloquialism of which the nick of time is the exact equivalent. But we have made grace to help in the nick of time, grace just when you and I and just there we need it. You're attacked by temptation at the moment of assault, you look to him and the grace is there to help you. The nick of time. No putting off praying until the evening when you're being tempted. There and then, in the city street, with the flaming temptation in front of you, turn to Christ," Morgan says, "and cry for help. And the grace will be there in the nick of time." Amazing. We do not have because we do not ask. Suddenly we fail because we don't ask. And that's the thing. Trust Jesus. I need to trust Jesus. You need to trust him. And he will not only sympathize with you, understand you, but he will sustain you. He will sustain me. And of course, grace in this context means enabling grace. Because those who already have Jesus as their high priest are already standing in the same saving grace of God. And it means helping, sustaining, enabling grace. So friends, today We have a great high priest who is supreme, and we have a high priest who is sympathetic, and we have a great high priest who is continually sustaining us. So may the Lord bless his work to us. We'll sing our last hymn. It's a song called Before the Throne of God Above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. Sing this to God's praise.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. I bring my priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me.
Please wait for a cup of tea if you can.